Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 3381 in the name of Keith Brown on a Scottish approach to the mental health and wellbeing of our veterans in each community. I'd invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Keith Brown to speak to and move the motion for around 13 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. Delighted to open this debate today as we emerge from the pandemic. However, having said that, the mental health of the whole population, of course, was a fundamental consideration for this government. And we have to be particularly mindful of the mental well-being of veterans, those who have sacrificed so much for us all. Our veterans and their families have had unique experiences that will have impacted on their mental health in numerous ways, and we are truly grateful for their service. I'd also like to thank my colleague, Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care, who proposed that we hold this joint debate today. And I acknowledge the excellent progress made in delivering the Veterans Mental Health Action Plan, produced by National Services Scotland's Scottish Veteran Care Network. In the process of delivering that plan, the veterans told us that veteran mental health services are not available throughout Scotland. That is currently dependent on where you live. That veterans are sometimes unclear as to what services are available and where to go for help. And while some statutory services are aware of the needs of veterans and their families, this is not universal. So I'll use some of my time today to describe how we will go further and make a real difference for people who need help and support, and how lived experience will play a fundamental role in shaping that. We are, of course, acutely aware of the challenges that the charitable sector has faced over the past 2 years and of the impact that the pandemic has had on their ability to deliver support. The response from our statutory bodies and the third sector partners has been outstanding. An example of this is the move to deliver innovative therapeutic services and counselling online. In addition to the pressures caused by the pandemic, in August last year, the withdrawal from Afghanistan affected veterans across the UK. And we know that veterans' mental wellbeing services in Scotland received a significant increase in demand from both veterans and family members who were concerned about their loved ones. We continue to engage with charities and with other service providers to ensure veterans receive the help they need for their mental health. And the Scottish Government has continued to fund specialist veteran mental health organisations such as Combat Stress and Veterans First Point. There are a number of priority areas that are important to me as a Cabinet Secretary with responsibility for veterans, and I'd like to touch briefly on some of these. In a visit to a drop-in centre last year, I heard firsthand from a female veteran who's continued to struggle with her mental health from her experience in the service. I was also able to hear about the benefit of having a local veteran-led service which understands the unique experiences of female veterans. And as well as our female veterans, we must also be aware of the specific needs of individuals from the LGBTQ plus community and early service leavers. For my part, I am supportive of the recent UK government commitment to an independent review of the pre-year 2000 treatment of LGBT veterans. And that includes a commitment to better understand the support needs of female veterans and veterans from ethnic minority backgrounds as well. And I look forward to the Scottish Government being able to contribute to and support the delivery of these commitments. And through the Scottish Veterans Fund, the Scottish Government is funding the work of Fighting with Pride, a charity supporting the health and well-being of LGBT veterans. All of our veterans need services that address their particular needs, and to do that, we need providers that understand their experiences. The UK Government has undertaken a consultation exercise that proposed to waive fees of £2,389 for non-UK service personnel if they apply to settle in the UK at the end of their military service. This was providing that they had served for 12 years or had been medically discharged relating to the service. In the Scottish Government response, and we'd raised this before the consultation process had started, we raised the issue of excessive costs of immigration application fees and the need for a more flexible immigration system that meets specific needs of Scotland. We're talking about people that have served in the armed forces of this country and are not being given the ability, without a substantial fee, for them and their family to stay in this country. In our view, 12-year service was too long a requirement, and I believe that we should not charge settlement fees for those who have served in this country. We should not be excluding people because of their ability to pay, but we should be including those who can contribute to our country. And we want Scotland to be a country where our veterans are welcomed and their service is valued. In response to the UK government consultation, they have agreed to decrease the fee waiver stipulation from 12 years to 6 years. so fees will be waived for those who have been discharged due to an injury or illness attributable to service, irrespective of how long they have served. And that is a welcome step in the right direction. But it is disappointing that the UK Government did not go further and align the fee waiver with the 4-year reckonable service requirements imposed by the Home Office. The UK Government unfortunately chose not to make any changes to arrangements for dependents of non-UK Armed Forces personnel. And a more generous and compassionate approach to family migration policy is still required to ensure that our valued veterans and their family members are able to settle and make their lives in Scotland. Yes, I will do.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary giving way. And in the motion, he does talk about veterans and their families and has indeed mentioned families in that sense. Will he go on in his speech to talk about the support aimed at the families of veterans as well as veterans themselves?
Cabinet Secretary.
I will indeed, Dan. I think you'll find there's reference to families throughout my speech, and I'm sure it will be mentioned by the Minister when he speaks as well. So the Veteran Mental Health Action Plan highlights the need to look at what makes a good life in order to have good health. And just to underline the point that was just made, that the mental well-being of a veteran is, of course, inextricably linked with the mental well-being of their families, a very key point. And I'm also acutely aware of the link between good mental health and having a warm, safe home, a job and a loving relationship. Members, I think, will be aware of our commitment to work collaboratively with stakeholders to improve services and support in these areas. That includes the Veterans Employability Strategic Group and the Veterans Scotland Housing Group. I've often thought there's a tripod to making sure that the veterans can reintegrate back into civilian life, and that involves housing, health and employment. And if one of those is missing, that can cause major problems. So we commissioned the Veterans Scotland Housing Group to develop a pathway to prevent homelessness for veterans, and I'm pleased that their report was published earlier this year. I know that's an issue very close to the heart of the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care, who had responsibility for this previously as well. Now, that was a collaborative process and undertaken in a spirit of we want to see that collaborative process mirrored in other ways as well. So we'll continue to work closely with partners, including the armed forces community and the housing sector, to consider the implementation of the 24 recommendations contained within the report. And if I can touch on the third of those things, employability, most service leavers and veterans in Scotland enter work and are successful in the labour market. However, we know that some will face barriers to employment and some will be able to get a job very quickly, but they'll not get one that's commensurate with the experience and the skills that they had from their time in the armed forces. And at a time when so many sectors are reporting labour market and skill shortages, it's more vital than ever that those with skills and experience have access to the help they need. And for those who need to reskill, a wide range of employment and skill support is available. But we know that despite the availability of advice and support, some veterans are still not able to access the help they need, and I recognise that we need to go further. So we'll continue to work with partners across Scotland to change this and to ensure that every service leaver and veteran who is able to has the opportunity to enter sustained and fair work. The Armed Forces Personnel and Veterans Health Joint Group is a key part of improving access to healthcare. It will continue to prioritise mental health. And other significant work that the Joint Group is progressing is around the greater identification of veterans within our healthcare system. That will enable veterans to be signposted to and to access the most appropriate support services for their needs. The Joint Group also recognises that living with long-term physical health conditions as a result of military service can have a substantial negative effect on mental health, and we are exploring how we can establish a service which will provide a comprehensive pathway connecting veterans to the right help. And we want that help to be available for both their physical and mental health needs, recognising the two will often, of course, be linked. And I'd like to thank the NHS National Support Services Scottish Veteran Care Network for recognising the issues raised by veterans and for producing a number of principles informed by these issues in the Veteran Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan. The Government endorses the proposal that veterans should be able to access services easily and at the right time. And when they do, those who provide services to veterans should understand their needs. So we'll continue the work of the Scottish Veteran Care Network, putting veterans at the heart of the implementation process. And in order to deliver services at the right time and the right place, it's vitally important that we have the right information. So I'm pleased that our understanding of veterans' needs will be further enhanced by the results of the 2022 census. We'll also have access to the results from the same information relating to veterans that is now included in Scotland's 3 primary household surveys. So these are just some of the issues that we know veterans face in terms of good mental health, housing, employability pathways to help and support, early identification by the system, what has previously been a lack of good data and stigma. And only through that cross-policy approach, with a focus on improving each of those issues and more, will we be able to ensure that our veterans can enjoy good mental health. As we move to the next stage of the plan, we will establish a veteran-led implementation board to lead on the delivery of the plan. And I am pleased to announce that the appointment of Mr Charles Winstanley as the chair of the Action Plan Implementation Board. Charles is a veteran of impeccable standing who has experience of leading the delivery of NHS services, as well as third sector services and mental health research. The Implementation Board will report to myself and to the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care on its progress. And it will oversee the work of the Scottish Veteran Care Network. It will also advise on both the structure and funding requirements to make the principles in the plan a reality. So for many years, the Scottish Government has supported veterans and their families through the innovative work of Veterans First Point and Combat Stress. We have funded both organisations to provide specific mental health services for veterans and their families. I should say none of this funding is recognised in terms of consequentials or money coming specifically for that purpose for Westminster, but that has never stopped us implementing it and increasing it where we can. And I'm pleased to announce today that we are providing further funding in the next year to the 6 Veterans First Point centres. These are in Tayside, Lanarkshire, Ayrshire, Narran, Fife, Borders and Lothian. The funding of £666,000 will enable the Veterans First Point centres to provide mental health support to veterans and their families in this transitions phase. And I'd also want to announce further funding of £1.4 million to combat stress so that organisation continue its important work. They are, of course, relocating services to Glasgow and Edinburgh and thereby providing more accessible routes to support. Presiding Officer, before I conclude my remarks today, I wanted to mention that the Veterans Commissioner, Charlie Wallace, will be publishing his final report later this month. His advice and recommendations on veterans' health are another vital set of tools to inform our work. And I'd like to place on record my sincere thanks to Charlie for his contributions during his tenure as Commissioner, which will end in late March. On behalf of Scotland's service personnel, veterans and their families, I wish him well for the future. I should say one or two things just about the amendments proposed, Presiding Officer. First of all, in relation to the Labour amendments, I agree that as we develop our new suicide prevention strategy that we should engage with organisations representing veterans' interests, ensuring we capture the right outcomes and actions required to further mitigate suicide risk amongst veterans. The Minister will say more on this, but I should say that we are happy to accept the Labour amendment in this regard. On the Conservative amendment, I've never seen an amendment like this during the 10 or so years where I've been looking at veterans' debates in this chamber. It guts, it fillets completely the government motion and then reinstates some of the points in it. I don't know whether this signifies a departure. We've had a remarkable degree of cross-party consensus in veterans' debate. I know that's really appreciated and valued by the veterans community who like to see that consensus, but this marks a departure and it shows us how much Maurice Corry, I think, is missed. I do welcome the point that's made in the amendment about the UK's government's veterans recognition scheme and the support to implement the action plan. It's important that, should they choose to do so, of course, veterans have the ability to easily identify themselves as veterans when accessing services. So I welcome the UK government's plans to undertake a scoping study for provision of digital verification of veterans, but I cannot support the Conservative amendment, and I really regret the fact they've sought to try and undermine this debate in the way that they have. I do, though, wholly endorse the key principles in the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan. I know there is a cross-party consensus on the importance of this issue, at least, and I look forward to working with members across the Chamber in the support of mental health of all our veterans and their families and service leavers in Scotland. And I would propose a motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I can inform the Chamber that the time we had available across the afternoon was exhausted earlier on in business, so I'm going to have to ask members to stick to their time allocations and accommodate any interventions within those allocations, if at all possible. And I call on Craig Hoy to speak to and move Amendment 3381.1 for around 9 minutes, Mr Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Minister for his opening remarks. I'm very pleased to open this debate on behalf of my party, and can I start by proposing the amendment in my name. We believe that veterans must be able to secure the right help at the right time through access to mental health and wellbeing services that are timely, high quality and right for them as individuals. And we recognise the importance of supporting veterans, and we greatly value the significant contribution that they make in Scotland today. The Scottish Conservatives will always stand up for our armed forces. some of whom today are headed to Eastern Europe to support NATO as it reinforces its eastern flank. And today we thank each and every one of them for their service, as well as remembering those who have paid the ultimate price in defence of our freedoms. We owe them a debt of gratitude that must be realised by more than words in ceremonies, important as these are. It must be repaid by a commitment to look after them and their families throughout their lives, something administrations of all parties have all too often failed to do. When we hear of a veteran who is homeless, we should feel a sense of collective shame. When we hear of a veteran who is struggling with alcohol or drug addiction issues, we should be ashamed. When we hear of a veteran struggling with PTSD or facing mental health challenges, we should all share that sense of collective shame. And when we hear of a veteran who takes his or her own life, we should feel more than shame. It is simply not acceptable that people who were willing to lay down their lives for us then go on to take their own lives because of the adverse experiences they faced. And that is why I today support, and we will support the government, today we must answer a collective call for action. And that's why we welcome the 38 recommendations and principles in the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan. We need to come together across this Parliament to tackle these problems once and for all, and to do so in a timely way. And that is why the Scottish Conservatives propose an Armed Forces and Veterans Bill, mirroring a similar move at Westminster in December. The bill would enshrine into law the Armed Forces Covenant for devolved public bodies, such as the NHS and local government. And the Covenant focuses on supporting members of the Armed Forces, the community and their families. It will support them to access education, securing a home, starting a new career, accessing healthcare or financial assistance, and providing them with discounted services. The bill would deliver specific provisions to enhance the benefits and support available to veterans as they transition into civilian life. Now, let me be clear that while the vast majority of veterans leave their service greatly enhanced by their time in the military, the extent of mental health problems for those who served in our armed forces remains unclear. The Scottish Veterans Health Study shows that veterans with long service histories are in fact less likely to suffer a range of health-related conditions compared to the general population. Rates of mental illness amongst UK ex-service personnel are generally lower than that of the wider population, 1 in 5 compared to 1 in 4 in the general population. But still, the Ministry of Defence reported 1,578 medical discharges in 2020, and of these, 34% were on medical health grounds. This means that roughly 50 veterans per year declare a mental health difficulty at the point of discharge. But there are many reasons why difficulties might not be declared at this point. And I am pleased, therefore, that the Scottish Parliament has agreed that the Scottish Census will provide a question on previous service in the UK Armed Forces. This information will provide a far more accurate picture of the geographical spread of veterans in Scotland, and it will overcome the limitations, which mean it is difficult to estimate the numbers and location of veterans in Scotland, let alone exploring their mental health. We must be committed to getting veterans the help they earned and the support that they deserve. And can I commend those organisations who work with our service personnel and veterans? Organisations like the Scottish Veterans Care Network, like Combat Stress, which provides a range of community outpatient and residential mental health services, and organisations such as the Royal British Legion and Poppy Scotland, or Forces Line, a free confidential helpline that is completely independent of the military chain of command. Deputy Presiding Officer, we know that there are a significant group of service leavers more at risk of poor mental and physical health, and this is due to a number of factors. Veterans who are younger, veterans who are unemployed, or veterans who are unable to work due to long-term illness or disability, or the service personnel who identify as LGBTQ+, and who were forced shamefully to hide their sexuality. Those personnel who, because of institutional homophobia, faced dishonourable discharge, or the veterans who are single or divorced, or the female veterans who are highlighted as an at-risk group to suicide, or the black and minority ethnic service personnel, or early service leavers who show higher rates of heavy drinking, suicide and self-harm, or the deployed reservists who are at higher risk from mental health problems. We also know that veterans currently presenting to mental health and wellbeing services in Scotland may have experienced a wide range of issues. And based on this information, there is clearly a case for highlighting veterans as a priority group. There is a need to develop specific tailored veteran mental health services across the governments of the UK. And that's why I do believe that it is important that we do have a four nations approach to that. And I therefore welcome the strategy for our veterans, that has the backing of all four governments. And while delivery will look different across the country, by signing up to the strategy, all parts of the UK are committed to a shared vision. The collective ownership of the strategy has been welcomed by the third sector. Chris Hughes of Veterans Scotland spoke of how this approach puts the need of veterans before party politics, which of course it should. Deputy Presiding Officer, I support the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Plan, and I call on the Scottish Government and its agencies to assess and, wherever possible, to implement its 38 recommendations. And as our amendment makes clear, which I do hope the Minister might want to reflect upon, it is meant to be constructive. We want to see a timeline put in place so that veterans do not have to wait for 5 or 10 years for these issues to be addressed. We want to put in place measures such as expanding telephone support services and the creation of a Scottish Veteran Community Online Resources Hub, and to develop quality outcome indicators to support veterans' mental health and wellbeing services to demonstrate outcomes and enhance improvement, and to develop an all-important anti-stigma campaign to encourage veterans to seek support where it is required. Minister, without deadlines, there is no effective plan. According to Veterans Scotland, there are currently over 30 organisations providing health and wellbeing support to veterans. These organisations cover a multitude of projects within their respective communities, and we should support them. And I welcome the Minister's announcement of additional funding out of the record £41 billion settlement that we have from the UK Government. Deputy First Minister, Deputy Presiding Officer, it is sobering today to consider the young, brave Ukrainians who are returning to their country to take up arms against Putin's revolting regime. Brave individuals who are willing to die for their country, people who put themselves in harm's way for a greater good. Our young service men and women have shown the same sense of selfless commitment at home and abroad for generations. And let us be in no doubt that the bombs and missiles which accompany the drumbeat of war in mainland Europe today will undoubtedly affect many of our own veterans. It will reawaken past trauma and it will open old wounds. Our armed forces have earned our respect. They have earned a debt of gratitude. Their mental health challenges can no longer go ignored. Their welfare is our responsibility. They served to keep us safe, and we owe them their safety, and we cannot allow their welfare to be overlooked for any longer. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Hoy. I now call on Paul Sweeney to speak to Move Amendment 338.1.2 for around 7 minutes, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'd like to begin my remarks by sharing the sentiment from across the Chamber of solidarity with the people of Ukraine, who are showing such immense bravery in the face of continued aggression from Putin's barbaric regime. And I extend that solidarity to many of the Russian conscripts who are clearly caught up in a situation they didn't expect to get caught up in, and that exploitation is also something worthy of condemnation and solidarity. Deputy Presiding Officer, our veterans community is owed a huge debt of gratitude for their service to our country. Whether they served in European conflicts many decades ago, conflicts in the Middle and Far East, or in the Falklands War, each and every one of them should be immensely proud of their commitment to defend our country, often in the darkest of times. As someone who has been a member of the Army Reserves for over a decade, I know on a deeply personal level the sacrifices members of our armed forces make. Their role is a vocation, one which means spending huge periods of time away from family and friends, and one which often leaves them isolated from civilian life. Which is why I'm delighted to finally see publication and recommendations put forward by the Scottish Veterans Care Network report. It's also why I'm particularly pleased to see this emphasis that it places on mental health and wellbeing services, which feature very prominently within the report. Poor mental health is incredibly prevalent within the veterans community for obvious reasons, and I do have concerns about how the pandemic in recent years has exacerbated that situation. We know the isolation that the impact that had on our veterans community was particularly stark, and the number of veterans dying as a result of suicide in 2021 was at its highest level since 2005. So it's an issue we have known as a cause of huge concern for a long time. That's why our amendment calls for veterans at risk of suicide to be specifically considered in the Scottish Government's new suicide prevention strategy for Scotland, a strategy that, frankly, has taken too long to develop, but is nonetheless welcome and is now delayed until September 2022. Nonetheless, I thank the Minister for indicating that he will support our amendment to add this to the face of the motion in the Government's name. I do welcome the recommendation in the Scottish Veterans Care Network report that veterans should have equal access to mental health and wellbeing services regardless of where they live, and that each NHS board, in collaboration with health and social care partnerships, will have a dedicated community-based veteran mental health and wellbeing service. Because, Deputy Presiding Officer, the report highlights the significant geographic variation in terms of service provision and a lack of clarity around who to contact initially for help. And when they do, they are often lost in a fragmented and unresponsive system. Alongside the concerns raised about that lack of coordination between NHS Community Services and the broader third sector provision, it has the potential to prevent veterans seeking support from accessing it. And that can often be catastrophic. That cannot be allowed to happen, and I'm hopeful that this step will ensure that that is the case. The recommendations around support at the right time are also warmly welcome. We know that support is most effective when it's sought out, and our services do require significant flexibility to react at short notice. Currently, it's fair to say that access to support services is too incoherent and variable in quality, and not all veterans who are seeking help are able to access it quickly enough. I'd also like to welcome the suggestion that UK support services have access to information on Scottish services and sources of information. Our veterans community is often highly mobile, meaning that continuity and consistency of information, regardless of where they are located, should be of paramount importance. Ultimately, we are seeking to simplify a complex system, and I think small improvements like this could make a huge difference to saving lives and improving lives. Deputy Presiding Officer, finally, on the report itself, I do welcome the general points around developing an anti-stigma campaign while improving public awareness, knowledge and understanding of veterans' needs. The reality of the situation that most of us will know someone who is classed as a veteran, but we might not always be aware of their needs or the type of tailored support which would be helpful to them. And on stigma specifically, disinformation in combat situations can be rife, and it is easy for public perception to become clouded and for veterans to be stigmatised as a result. So I warmly welcome the recommendation of an anti-stigma campaign. It is an honourable thing to serve your country. Deputy Presiding Officer, overall, I think there's much to be welcomed in the report, but there are some wider points I feel could and should have been included. For years, stakeholders in the sector have been warning of an information vacuum. In order to fully understand the needs of the community, we need to understand the community itself. Data on veterans is often scarce, disjointed and outdated, and as a community, they are traditionally difficult to define, and as such, we have no definitive and conclusive understanding of its size or other characteristics. The report does mention the collation of increased data, particularly the new census question, and intelligence to improve our understanding of the community, and I welcome that, but I remain concerned with the pace of progress. I'm also increasingly concerned... Happy to give way. Yeah.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Paul Sweeney for giving way. And when he talks about the community, we're not just talking about the veterans themselves, but also their families. And one of the challenges with the census data is it will require additional data mining to identify the young people, spouses of veterans and their families. And it might have been easier to encompass that in the first place to have capture the information straight away.
Paul Sweeney.
Well, my friend raises an extremely important point about data interdependency, and that metadata will be critical to build that network of understanding of who are dependents of veterans and some of the wider implications that may bring about, often people who have lived in service accommodation. So I am concerned about the report in that sense, though it seeks to address this with perceived gaps in the system, because when people fall between the cracks, including families, it has real-life consequences. Indeed, just this week, I was contacted by the daughter of Donnie Watt, an 85-year-old veteran from Glenrothes in Fife. Donnie was an intelligence officer for the RAF in Berlin during the Cold War and was diagnosed with dementia in 2017. But since then, Donnie has been confined to hospital wards in Fife and has just spent 5 months of the last 5 years at home with his family. Donnie's daughter, Jane, feels that veterans' complex medical needs, like in Donnie's case, are being overlooked with a stretched NHS. The Health and Social Care Partnership responsible say that Donnie's case is just complex and veteran-specific needs are difficult. I don't think that's good enough. Deputy Presiding Officer, that does not mean that Donnie and other veterans like him are not worthy of the bespoke time and care needed to make them comfortable. The problem is we don't know how many Donnies are out there. Until we collate and analyse all the data available to us, we will never know, and veterans like Donnie will continue to suffer a diminished quality of life. Yes, happy to give way.
Very briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, just very briefly. I mean, I agree with the point that's been made, but would the member recognise that we have tried for years and years to get information on veterans in Scotland from the UK government without any success? And the first opportunity we have to do that is through the census.
Mr Sweeney, and you should be winding up now.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I recognise the complaint. It's certainly something I made frequently as a member of the House of Commons, and I recognise that we've made a breakthrough, but let's exploit this to its full potential. So I would urge the Government to take these points into consideration, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Sweeney. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton for around 6 minutes, Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. May I apologise to the Chamber for having to leave the debate early. I'm very privileged to speak for my party in this important debate, and I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for securing parliamentary time for it. In recent days, we have been served with a grim reminder of the horrors of war and the horrendous toll it takes on all of those who are caught up in it, none more so than those serving on the front line. And as we look on in horror at the events in Ukraine, we see the actions of those who stand in defiance of the outrageous and barbaric actions of the Putin regime. No one could argue anything other than those who are holding the line are exhibiting a staggering degree of heroism and sacrifice that is common to veterans the world over. As a Quaker, I find the idea of armed conflict very difficult. I am repelled by it. But, Presiding Officer, you can hate war with every fibre of your being, but still give thanks to the service and sacrifice of those who fight it. Those positions are not mutually exclusive. And we are incredibly fortunate that thousands of our own service, men and women, step forward in times of crisis so that the rest of us don't have to. Today, it is absolutely right that we recognise that bravery and honour their sacrifice. Presiding Officer, my office has been in touch with the veterans' mental health charity, Combat Stress, who shared with me the compelling story of a veteran who served 12 years in the RAF. If I may, I'd like to share some of the experience with the Chamber. He writes, "My problem started once I'd retired. I don't want to talk about all I saw and what I went through in Northern Ireland, but it's definitely what caused my mental health issues. My wife, she saw that I was struggling, having nightmares and flashbacks. Loud noises really bothered me, so I avoided going into town as I had flashbacks as if I was going out on patrol. I was always hyper aware of my surroundings. My mind felt locked, ready to protect and to defend. And everything came to a head when one day I was out and I heard a car backfiring. I just ran. I was crying in a total panic. Luckily, a policeman realised I was a veteran, understood my panic and got me home. I knew I needed help." Presiding Officer, it is sadly not uncommon for some service personnel to have left the armed forces many years ago and still be struggling to adjust to civilian life. They are still fighting the wars that the world has long since left behind. And all too often, they do not know where to turn. The invisible scars they bear can have a knock-on effect on their family relationships and employment. As we've heard in this debate, the incidence of homelessness and drug misuse among our veteran population is disproportionately high. And sometimes they face delays in accessing mental health treatment due to stigma and gaps in provision. I'm thankful to the many great organisations such as Combat Stress, Poppy Scotland and Help for Heroes for stepping in to fill the void which has sadly been left by the Scottish Government in this area. To give just one example, over the last 12 months, Combat Stress carried out nearly 5,000 appointments with 526 veterans across Scotland. As wonderful as that work of our veterans and mental health charities are, they are still reeling from 2 years of the pandemic and the massive impact that that has had on their ability to raise funds. Presiding Officer, it is not the third sector alone that should be providing the support that our veterans so sorely deserve. The state has a duty too. It is, after all, the state that sends servicemen and women into harm's way, and it is the duty for the state to care for them on their way home and when they return home. I'm sure that's something we can all agree on, and it's vital that NHS boards, health and social care partnerships, local authorities and the third sector are appropriately supported to meet the needs of all veterans. So I am pleased that the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan has been published and that, as I understand it, veterans charities were given the opportunity to help shape it. But, presiding officer, during this debate, I have received texts from a veteran who is angry at what he has heard, that while the Cabinet Secretary's words are warm, we are still being outstripped by England. NHS England began the rollout of Op Courage, their new scheme for supporting veterans' mental health last year. It fast-tracks those veterans into mental health support. And it would be very helpful to understand if the Scottish Government has looked at that approach and what aspects it can emulate up here, or whether it will just adopt Op Courage right now in Scotland, because it is needed. Presiding officer, all veterans should be able to access the same high standard of support no matter where they are based, and any wait for access must end immediately. In the documentary, Thank You for Your Service, Army psychologist General Laurie Sutton said, "We were not allowed to speak of the unseen wounds of war. We were not allowed to prepare for them." Presiding officer, our veterans deserve the utmost respect and the acknowledgement for their sacrifices that they have made while carrying out on duty in the service of this country. It is now our duty to ensure that they are given all the support and care that they need so that there is the prospect that those unseen wounds might, in some way, begin to heal.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Cole Hamilton. I now call on Graham Day, who will be followed by Finlay Carson for around 6 minutes, Mr. Day.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much welcome the scheduling of this debate because of the importance of the subject matter and a potential sea change in the bringing together of the support being afforded those within our veterans community requiring that, wherever they may live. The Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan is a very significant step forward in Scotland's commitment to supporting those veterans who have paid a legacy price for their service. And the fact the recommendations are a co-production between people who know and understand what it is to operate within the armed forces, those who work with veterans, and those with expertise in health and mental health and service design and implementation, for me, that gives them important added credibility. But if I may, Presiding Officer, I want for a moment to go back a little in recent history to offer credit where it's due for the position we find ourselves in today, with the Veterans Care Network established and the plan being taken forward. Firstly, the part played by the former Veterans Commissioner, Eric Fraser, and all of this must be acknowledged. It was Eric's report, Veterans Health and Wellbeing, a distinctly Scottish approach, which set us off in this direction. But at the risk of embarrassing him, let me also acknowledge the role of the Cabinet Secretary as well, for it was Keith Brown, when he previously had responsibility in Government for Veterans, who established the post of Veterans Commissioner. Credit also to Keith Brown for the part he played in getting us where we are today, and can I say how pleased I am to see him once again holding this responsibility. Presiding Officer, it's widely recognised that in many ways Scotland does better by its veterans and their families than other countries. That has never generated, nor should it ever lead to, complacency. We have always strived to do better, and the creation of the Scottish Veterans Care Network is proof of that. The action plan for me is clear evidence of the network already proving its worth. Historically, as former MSP Mike Rumbles, who championed this cause in the last Parliament, claimed, there was a degree of postcode lottery about access to services for veterans, almost entirely born out of a lack of understanding more than anything, in my opinion, but it was there. Where it was good, where the services were good, they were very good. But where they weren't, well, at the heart of the problem was a failure to grasp that veterans, at least those perhaps in most need of support, don't always readily seek it, especially if they feel they'll be dealing with folk who don't understand them or what they've been through. And even when they want help, they may have little idea how to access it. Presiding Officer, that's why the establishment of the Care Network and the implementation of this action plan is so essential. We need all our veterans to have direct, where possible on their doorstep, access to the services they and their families require. And the announcement today about the implementation board to oversee all this is very welcome. As the action plan highlights, to deliver what we'll need will require flexibility depending on population size and reality. In some places, we'll need to establish a new and distinct mental health and wellbeing service, and we'll need to be creative around pathways and make use of digital resources and technology. As others have noted, the 2022 census will be essential in helping us better understand where our veterans are located, in order that we best shape and provide the services they may need. Presiding Officer, it's important to recognise that the vast majority of service leavers adapt to civilian life very well. But MOD figures show that of the 1,578 medical discharges from the forces in 2020, just over a third were on mental health grounds, We also need to remember there's often a delayed onset to PTSD, sometimes as much as 14 years. So there is no doubting that a need exists and will continue to exist for mental health services and more. And the more in all of this really matters. As the plan highlights, what's needed is a better joined up, holistic approach where matters such as housing, education, employment are also addressed and the needs of the wider family are taken into account. President Officer, there is no questioning the commitment of this government to supporting our veterans community. There are many in that community who, whilst they might not necessarily share the politics of this administration, would willingly attest to that. Most recently, that's been seen in the Scottish Government stepping in to provide financial backing for the Unforgotten Forces Consortium and the creation of a £1 million fund to provide direct financial relief to those third sector organisations who support our veterans in Scotland. There's also been commitment to increase the Veterans Fund to £500,000 per annum from 2022-23, and the Cabinet Secretary's announcement today around V1P and combat stress is hugely important. There has been ongoing work in other areas, specific work in the areas of housing, education, mental health and social isolation. However, there is more to be done and the action plan helps point the way in that regard. I particularly welcome the recommendation that the community-based veteran mental health and wellbeing service should include peer support workers. I also welcome the requirement for the planned regional implementation teams to include veteran navigators. But of all the recommendations contained in the action plan, perhaps 2.3 is the one which best demonstrates how switched on it is, as evidenced in particular by the call for the development of specific processes for early service leavers with complex psychological needs. This is a cohort we all know to be requiring particular attention. President Officer, the action plan for me represents a major step forward in the development of the kind of pulled-together support which ought to be available to our veterans wherever in Scotland they reside. If we can deliver on it in full, then alongside the excellent work continuing to be done by the veterans third sector, then we really will have a truly holistic first-class offering for our veterans. There is much to be done to ensure the plan's ambitions are realised in their entirety, but its content and the Cabinet Secretary's comments today leave me with a sense of optimism. And on that note, I want to encourage members to support the motion in Keith Brown's name. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Day. I now call on Finlay Carson to be followed by Christine Graham for around 6 minutes, Mr. Carr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, there is an estimated 5 million veterans living in the UK at present, with a further 20,000 personnel leaving the armed forces every year. When they do leave, their health care automatically transfers from the military to the National Health Service. And according to figures from HM Forces, only around 0.1% of regular service personnel are discharged annually for mental health reasons. Sadly, however, many veterans develop mental health problems after leaving the service, many of whom will be experiencing post-traumatic stress disorder. Of course, many of the mental health problems experienced by ex-military personnel are the same as the general population, although these experiences, the experiences during service and the transition to civilian life mean that their mental health may be adversely affected by factors such as PTSD, depression and anxiety. Tragically, only half of those experiencing mental health problems sought help from the NHS, and those that did were rarely referred to mental health specialist services. Worryingly, levels of alcohol misuse overall were substantially higher than in the general public. So veterans' mental health problems may be worse or caused by post-service factors such as difficulties in making the transition to civilian life or marital problems and associated loss of family and social support networks. And young veterans are at high risk of suicide in the first 2 years after leaving service and vulnerable to social exclusion and homelessness, both of which we know to be risk factors in mental health. Certainly.
Paul Sweeney.
May we agree that a particularly difficult cohort are those who are discharged on an unplanned basis, for example, for failing a compulsory drugs test, and they're often not given the support necessary to support them into civilian life?
Finlay Carson.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that intervention. There's a range of different, unique situations that our veterans find themselves in, and those need to be addressed in a unique and a proper way. The position that many veterans find themselves in is unacceptable, and it's vital that they're able to secure the right help at the right time through access to mental health and wellbeing services that are timely, high quality and specifically tailored for them as individuals and not a one-size-fits-all approach. It's an important that servicemen and women who choose to settle in Scotland upon leaving the forces know from the outset they are settling in a land fit for heroes, a place that offers them support for them and their families, which is at least on par with other parts of the UK. And I support the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Plan, and today call on the Scottish Government to accept its recommendations and fund it generously so our veterans can fulfil their potential and access appropriate support when they face difficult times. At present, Scotland does have a range of quality services, but sadly, as we've already heard, this support can be haphazard. The Veterans Commissioner concluded that support can be piecemeal on occasions and often quite limited for those with the most complex and difficult conditions. And the Commissioner has previously urged the Scottish Government to publish a mental health action plan, and this is something that I hope the Minister can do as a matter of urgency, because it's vital that the Scottish Government work with NHS Scotland to produce an action plan for the long-term delivery of services and support. And I know and appreciate that both the UK and the Scottish Governments have worked together in the past to publish a joint strategy for our veterans, and this collaboration needs to continue in the future for the good of all our ex-service personnel. Deputy Presiding Officer, can I take this opportunity to highlight a few things involving veterans living in my constituency of Galloway in West Dumfries? In particular, the wonderful Veterans Garden in Dumfries that provides a safe place for serving armed forces personnel and local veterans and their families to meet up for a cuppa, a catch-up, as well as provide mutual support for one another when needed. It's truly a wonderful example of how people can help each other in times of need. The gardens are absolutely immaculately kept and help create a sense of well-being and togetherness. And the men and women who look after it deserve great credit. Party politics aside, it would be remiss of me not to mention the tremendous work carried out by the region's Armed Forces champion, Labour councillor Archie Drybra, who was awarded the MBE in the Queen's New Year's Honours in 2019. But unfortunately, due to the pandemic, Archie, a former Gordon Highlander, had to wait more than 2 years before finally being presented with his medal in recognition of the way he spearheaded the region's World War I centenary and Quinton Hill disaster commemorational events. Excuse me. Archie has always placed the welfare of serving and ex-forces personnel and their families as a priority. He's also heavily involved in organising another event later this month after Dumfries and Galloway Council honoured the Royal British Legion with Freeman status as an honour for their 100 years of service to veterans and their families. Time is short, Deputy Presiding Officer, but I'd also like to put on record the work of SWSRNR, and I know the former Veterans Minister, Graham Day, had visited them, and they're a charity who work alongside First Military Recruitment, and they've trained more than 60 former forces personnel to become HGV drivers. And it's a scheme and schemes such as this that provide hope and help to many of our ex-servicemen and women. The Scottish Conservatives will always stand up for our armed forces, and today we thank each and every one of them for their service commitment and sense of duty, as well, of course, remembering those who paid the ultimate price. We owe them a great deal of gratitude.
Thank you. I now call Paul O'Kane. I call Christine Graham, to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thought I'd changed identity for a moment there. Deputy Presiding Officer, it's a bitter irony that we debate today this issue when, as we speak, men and women on both sides in Ukraine are dying and injured in a conflict that's entirely manufactured. An invasion in Europe of a sovereign independent nation by a bellicose and expansionist regime led by paranoid megalomaniac Vladimir Putin. We in my lifetime have sent troops to the Falklands, Iraq twice, and Afghanistan. Each war is horrendous and destructive for generations. But today, with mobile phones providing instant local reporting, we are there with the people, with the soldiers, risking life and limb. It reminds us, as if we need a reminding, of the cost of conflict. Representing both Penicuik with Glencorse barracks nearby and the borders with centuries of tradition of army service, I've long held an interest not only in where and why we send our forces into conflicts, but what happens on their return. In my time in this Parliament, since 1999, we have gradually seen a recognition by the MOD, not only of its duty of care to troops on the front line, but on their return and for years afterwards. This is perhaps exemplified most by the Armed Forces Covenant, a statement of the moral obligation which exists between the UK, the UK government and the armed forces. Published in May 2011, its core principles were enshrined in law for the first time in the Armed Forces Act 2011, and I quote, that we acknowledge and understand that those who serve or who have served in the armed forces and their families should be treated with fairness and respect in their communities, economy and society they serve with their lives. Turning to the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan, its 38 recommendations are based upon three key principles, but I want to focus in the short time on one, and that is that veterans will have equal access to mental health and wellbeing services regardless of where they live, and I note the reference to the postcode lottery in previous times. And this should focus on keeping veterans and their families well by supporting, providing support for the wider determinants of mental health and wellbeing and as close to the home as possible. And the wider determinants I'll also mention. Nationally, over the years, the Scottish Government appointed a Scottish Veterans Commissioner. That was in 2014, currently referred to by a colleague as Charles Wallace, who had 35 years army service acting as an ambassador for improvements in supporting veterans. Wales is announcing one this year. I'm not aware of England announcing one, but I recommend that they do. The Scottish Veterans Fund was initiated in 2008-2009 and has received £1.7 million for over 180 projects. And the Scottish Government has committed last year, and again referred to increase the fund to £500,000 from 2022-23. But I want to focus on the Veterans Employability Strategic Group, which has membership of the private sector for the first time. The Scottish Government is launching a public awareness campaign on this. Because, as the Cabinet Secretary said, they're interlinked, health, a happy home and employment, and also helping the families. So some of the stresses of returning to civvies, and I accept that many return to these without an issue, but there are just that. Returning to civvies is very difficult, fitting in with employment demand, though many of the skills are often transferable. And the Mental Health Transition Recovery Plan, published last in October 2020, had a specific commitment to identify suicide prevention among veterans, also referred to by other speakers. Locally, we have the Veterans Centre in Dalkeith, which serves my constituents in Midlothian South. It's located in the heart of Dalkeith Town Centre, primarily designed as a drop-in centre with no appointments necessary, at least pre-COVID. And the aim was to advise and support former members of the armed forces, reservists and their families through Edinburgh and the Lothians through any disadvantage they have post-service. They have a small team of dedicated staff readily available to tackle any challenges that present, however minor or complex. They also have, I understand, weekly bacon roll mornings every Friday morning. I fancy going to that. They're extremely popular with a great atmosphere and naturally well attended. And there's the Veterans First Point in Gala Shields. I note the Cabinet Secretary announcing further funding for these initiatives. That's for ex-forces personnel and families and carers' support and advice. And the team has veterans as peer support workers, clinicians and therapists to listen and to help. For years, we have been aware that too many veterans, because of the disconnect when they left the forces and perhaps their experience of conflict, some went into a downward spiral with relationship breakups, addictions, homelessness and even criminality. And we've not always treated our veterans well, even when they were in the armed forces. Iraq, 2003-2008, they had poor equipment, the wrong shoes, the wrong vehicles. It's also sadly the case that for the Gulf War, 1990-91, veterans have had to fight for recognition of Gulf War syndrome. So, and as has been said also by my colleague, post-traumatic stress disorder manifests itself in many ways and over a long period of time. Finally, what I want to say is this. We as politicians, we are the people, perhaps not in this chamber, but across here, who send our soldiers, our armed forces into conflicts, mainly because we have failed. And we have therefore a huge duty to them once they are discharged, in whatever condition they are, when they are discharged. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Paul O'Kane, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Audrey Nicol. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I would want to begin by associating myself with the comments of colleagues on the unfolding horrors in Ukraine, and indeed once again to offer my solidarity to the Ukrainian people. Can I also thank Keith Brown for bringing this debate to the Chamber today? I know that for the Cabinet Secretary, Veterans Affairs are close to his heart, and indeed to the heart of many colleagues across the Chamber, not least my Labour colleague Paul Sweeney. And it was also great to hear Finlay Carson speak of Councillor Archie Dryburgh, a good colleague and someone I worked very closely with when I was in the Shropshire Council, and we both served on the Association of Public Sector Excellence. So absolutely well-made comments there. In recent years, I think it's clear that enormous strides have been made in wider society when we talk about mental health. Whether it's conversations with a loved one or a stranger on the street, it's good to see the whole country moving in a more positive path to talk about these issues. Indeed, to illustrate that point, recently in my office, we held a Time to Talk Day coffee and catch-up, where we all took a moment to help support one another with conversations about our mental health. And really what that brought home to me in terms of veterans is that we need to think more about how we tailor our approaches and our conversations for people who perhaps have been involved in active service over many years. And I think it's clear from all the contributions today that we do have more to do in that regard. I want to perhaps begin my remarks by commending the work of the Scottish Veterans Care Network and the development of their action plan for tackling mental health challenges for veterans. I think the report is to be welcomed, and I do hope that all of those recommendations will not just be accepted, but also fully implemented by the government. Vitally, I think we must ensure that we have adequate funding for this, as the third principle of that plan states that NHS boards, health and social care partnerships, local authorities and the third sector should be appropriately supported to meet the needs of veterans and develop and deliver veterans' mental health wellbeing support services. It's vital that the Scottish Government gives the bodies the right support and funding to ensure that these principles can be achieved. And with this, we in this Parliament must be able to track changes to ensure that they are fully implemented and that sustainable funding is made over years. Accountability, I think, is incredibly important to make sure that veterans feel fully supported when they retire from their respective service. We know the sacrifices that have been made, everything from risking their lives for our country, spending unimaginable long time away from their families, which can cause anxiety and emotional strain. So it should encourage us to do our very best for them, as they have done for us. And we also know what amazing assets veterans are to our communities and workplaces. Servicemen and women are adaptable, incredibly well-trained, and have a work ethic like no other. And we must ensure that we harness their potential and fully support them to transition smoothly into civilian life, wherever they choose to go. And I'd like to just take a moment, as colleagues have, to highlight the amazing contribution of third sector and charitable organisations in this regard. Particularly, I think of Erskine, who are based in my West Scotland region, and the amount of work that they do year on year to support people with housing benefits and support, or indeed getting back into the workplace. I would also like to welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments on LGBT plus veterans and the work that will be done to better understand their needs after long misunderstandings, I think, about their particular mental health challenges. And I'm thinking, of course, particularly of those who served prior to 2000, when the UK Labour government ended the ban on LGBT plus people serving openly in our armed forces. It is clear that there's more work to be done in that area to understand the particular needs of LGBT plus people coming out of our armed services. I think it is clear that there are some tragic situations continuing to unfold for veterans across our country. And indeed, throughout the pandemic, I think we've seen more and more veterans suffer from increased anxiety, isolation, job loss, and services being absent and being slower, perhaps, to respond to their needs. And the call that I think we've heard in the past from the Scottish Veterans Commissioner is for strengthened strategic leadership and for an effort to be made to support partnerships across Scotland. I think in some ways it is regrettable that the new suicide prevention strategy for Scotland has been delayed until September 2022, because too many lives are currently being lost and we do need real and meaningful action as soon as possible. And I think, as my colleague Paul Sweeney As already mentioned today, Scottish Labour is clear that the Scottish Government must update this Parliament in advance of publication on the action being taken to deliver veteran-specific suicide prevention training and improve mental health support for veterans. And we very much welcome the acknowledgement of our amendment by the Cabinet Secretary in that regard. So to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe that those who have sacrificed the most for our country deserve the best care possible. While there has been priority given to the healthcare of veterans, we cannot become complacent about the quality of services, including mental health services. And I and my party will continue to call on greater access and availability of support services for our Scottish veterans. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Sue Webber. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I refer members to my register of interest. I'm a councillor in Aberdeen City Council. Last week, a family member WhatsApped me with a link to a Just Giving page asking, please donate to Scots Ultra Challenge. Scots Ultra was a 40-mile run that took place this weekend in memory of a promising young soldier who took his own life last year following a long struggle with mental ill health. Not a veteran, but when I read Scott's story, I felt an overwhelming sense of sadness and loss, perhaps subconsciously compounded by the events unfolding in the Ukraine, that I suspect for many is making the futility of conflict feel very real and frightening. In recent years, the focus on the mental health of armed services personnel has increased. Media coverage and the work of armed forces charities has raised public awareness of the impact of mental health conditions such as PTSD, depression and anxiety on our veterans. And the perception that service personnel leave the armed forces mad, bad or sad is both stigmatising and harmful. The majority leave with a positive experience. The sense of community offered in the military environment can make an invaluable contribution to their mental health. So around 2,020 veterans live in Scotland, and understanding this community is essential in ensuring that, and as Charles Wallace, the Veterans Commissioner, outlines in the new Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan, that no more veterans suffer due to gaps in service provision or lack of awareness of help that already exists. And much of that service provision requires understanding the risk factors for veterans, including age and employment status, housing and homelessness, the pandemic and gender. Recently, I spoke about female veterans in a debate, highlighting the disproportionate challenges women face from harassment, discrimination, sexual assault and other behaviours that impact their mental health and can place them at higher risk of self-harm and suicide. And I note Paul Sweeney's amendment makes reference to the new suicide prevention strategy and the opportunity to consider veterans within it. And I also want to highlight the risk from extremism, particularly far right-wing rhetoric that can feel attractive in line with the way an individual may view the world, particularly following their experience of active service. And this may seem like a far cry from life in Scotland, and to a great extent it is. Nonetheless, it is a factor that I consider requires ongoing monitoring. So as already highlighted, the Scottish Government has already made a £1 million in direct relief available to support armed forces community in Scotland, additional funding to organisations providing support to veterans and serving personnel, and continued funding for the Unforgotten Forces Consortium, a partnership of charities, including Combat Stress, already doing excellent work in Scotland. The Scottish Veterans Fund has provided over £1.7 million to over 180 projects, and of course, the £120 million Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund reflects the priority placed on improving mental health in Scotland. And in terms of services and support, the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan sets out the key principles around equity of access to services, accessing the right help at the right time, and ensuring services meet the needs of veterans. And at this point, I want to highlight the case of a constituent I supported, a veteran experiencing extreme anxiety during lockdown, arising from the behaviour of neighbours. And during a housing needs assessment, he was advised, and I quote, Any negative impact on a pre-existing mental health condition caused by neighbours' behaviour is not relevant to the housing assessment process. And these mental health issues do not prevent you accessing or functioning in your home. No understanding of his vulnerability as a veteran. So I ask the Scottish Government to ensure supporting veterans is not undermined by local approaches that seem unintentionally process-driven, not trauma-informed. The plan also highlights the important role of strong social networks. And here I give a nod to Cliff and John at the Portlethen Men's Shed in my constituency, both veterans, compassionate, supportive and welcoming. Aberdeen South and North Kincardine is also home to the Gordon Highlanders Museum, a tribute to the men of one of the finest regiments of the British Army and a place for veterans to come together to reflect and remember. And finally, I highlight the issue of veterans in custody and prison, often highly vulnerable and in poor mental health. And as the Cabinet Secretary knows, the Criminal Justice Committee made a range of recommendations in our Judged on Progress report around remand, problem drug use, rehabilitation and alternatives to prison, all highly relevant to veterans. And I ask that progress is made on our recommendations by the Scottish Government and criminal justice partners at pace. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, and perhaps most importantly, I pay tribute to all those serving personnel, veterans, their families, those supporting them, and to Scott and others who struggled with mental health was lost too soon. We thank you, we will work for you, and we remember you. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Sue Webber to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Webber.
Yes, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Like everyone in the Chamber today, we want servicemen and women who choose to settle in Scotland upon leaving our armed forces to know that they are settling in a land fit for heroes that offers them and their families the most generous support in any part of the UK. When I was out in the constituency last night, I met a veteran. And like all of us, they want to live and take active roles within their community. You can imagine we had quite an interesting discussion given the current state of affairs that we are facing in Europe. Yet he continues, as we all would be, to be as patriotic as ever. We support the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Plan and call on the Scottish Government to accept its recommendations and fund it generously, so that our veterans can fulfil their potential and get the support that they need. The Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Plan was developed with the Scottish Veterans Care Network and published in December 21, aims to ensure that veterans can lead a healthy, positive life and reach their full potential by accessing timely, high-quality wellbeing and mental health services, no matter where they live. The action plan has been developed through extensive engagement and collaboration and makes 38 recommendations, as we've heard today. Contributors included, but were not limited to, 80 veterans, IGBs, NHS colleagues, third sector veterans, mental health and wellbeing services, the MOD and national NHS boards. And while we recognise that the plan suggests timelines for delivery on the goals, these will vary across Scotland. And that's why we believe that the Scottish Government and the partner agencies should aim to assess and implement the 38 Action Plan recommendations within 24 months. As well as supporting this plan, the Scottish Conservatives proposed an Armed Forces and Veterans Bill to stand up for our soldiers. This bill would enshrine into law the Armed Forces Covenant for devolved public bodies such as the NHS and local government. And the Armed Forces Covenant focuses on supporting members of the Armed Forces community, getting access to education, having a home, starting a new career, healthcare, financial assistance and discounted services. And living where I live, this is important, with the close proximity that I have to both Dreghorn and Redford Barracks. The Scottish Conservatives fought for our service personnel to be exempt from Scotland's higher tax rates. The SNP broke their 2016 manifesto promise not to raise taxes, and this was set to target up to 7,000 of our armed forces personnel with those higher taxes. And after my Scottish Conservative MP colleague John Lamont raised this in the House of Commons, the UK Government stepped in to provide a Scottish income tax mitigation for personnel earning more than £28,443. I won't, thank you. This means members of the armed forces will receive the same income regardless of where they are domiciled in the UK. We also called for the introduction of a specific veterans help to buy scheme to help give veterans and their families more support when buying a home in Scotland. This was shut down, which helped by the SNP, which then helps people to get on the property ladder. We will help reinstate help to buy, whilst also setting up a specific element of the scheme that will support our armed forces veterans to step onto the property ladder and build their life and their home in Scotland. Not at the moment, thanks. Invaluable work is also done by non-government organisations, and I would like to pay tribute to SAFA, the Armed Forces Charity, the Soldiers, Sailors, Airmen and Families Association that I met in West Lothian prior to my election in this chamber, as my sister was a volunteer there. It's a UK charity with groups across the country that provides lifelong support to serving men and women and veterans from the British Armed Forces and their families or dependents. SAFA helps the Armed Forces community in several ways, including helping with issues of addiction, relationship breakdown, debt, homelessness, post-traumatic stress, depression and disability. And it's imperative, as we've heard today, to recognise the stresses that families face too as the support service personnel who are having difficulties. Partners often struggle as they support their loved ones, whether they are on active service or come to terms with what they have faced. SAFA focuses on rebuilding lives. We want to make Scotland an attractive part of the UK for those who leave the armed forces to settle in. And it is clear from what I have said today that the Scottish Conservatives continue to strive for this day in and day out. The Scottish Conservatives will always stand up for our armed forces. And today, we thank each and every one of them for their service, as well as remembering those who have paid the ultimate price. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Gillian Mackay to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. One in 10 UK Armed Forces personnel were seen by military healthcare services for a mental health-related reason in 2020-2021. Although this represents a fall compared to 2019-20, this may be attributable to a reduction in routine and training activity during lockdowns. As the Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan states, the Ministry of Defence reported 1,578 medical discharges across the UK in 2020. It is estimated that 34% of these were on mental health grounds. As a proportion of the veterans' population in Scotland, this equates to approximately 50 veterans per year declaring a mental health difficulty at point of discharge. Veterans, therefore, need access to mental health support and treatment, just like the rest of us, although, as others have noticed, stigma is a specific factor. But we also must acknowledge that veterans are also exposed to stressors and experiences that most of the general population are not, and any mental health support must be person-centred. As we've heard, the action plan is based on three key principles, which centres on veterans having timely access to well-planned mental health and wellbeing services, no matter where they live. It is vital that these principles are adhered to so that no one slips through the cracks and is unable to access the support they need. Some of the issues we see are similar to those we've discussed before for the general population, and some treatment will be specific to veterans. As a party, we would always advocate for peaceful resolutions rather than armed conflict, but we recognise that for those who have been involved in previous conflict, person-centred care is important to ensure that they can deal with their experiences. As the motion notes, we need to deliver holistic care that takes account of the entirety of an individual's needs. This will include services including housing and rehabilitation where appropriate. This should also take account of situations for families and particularly children. It is hard not to reference the situation in Ukraine while looking at this debate. For those who have may experienced armed conflict, the blanket coverage of the current war may be a re-traumatising experience, and I would encourage anyone experiencing a deterioration in their mental health due to this to seek help. I would also like us to consider how we can support the children of those who may have been involved in war. I'm sure we've all seen the young child on the news over the last few days having been forced to flee, telling the reporter that their father had stayed behind to fight. For young people, information and pictures from war are much more available than they may have been previously. And for children of veterans, and indeed for anyone that may come to Scotland from conflict zones, I hope we're able to give them the appropriate support, and indeed whole family support where appropriate. There should also be an appropriate treatment mix, including counselling and trauma support services, to give support in the most appropriate format for individuals. As in non-veteran health support, we need to ensure that people only have to explain their trauma or symptoms as many times as necessary. With some current practices, people may have to repeat their story many times to different clinicians. Ensuring that we can share data effectively is very important. Any veteran who's been disabled as a result of their deployment should not have to repeat their story every time they need physical support, and this should be the same for mental health support. We must also consider unmet need. The action plan highlights that there are many reasons that individuals may not declare difficulties at discharge, including issues around discrimination and stigma. Studies have shown that stigma is particularly problematic for people in the armed forces, where physical and psychological resilience in the face of adversity is promoted and valued. PTSD can develop years after a traumatic experience. Delayed onset PTSD may make it difficult to determine the true extent of mental health problems amongst veterans. A study published last year by researchers from the University of Glasgow highlighted that, and I quote, "The risk of suicide among UK military veterans remains unclear. Few recent studies have been undertaken, and most studies found no clear evidence of increased risk," end quote. It's clear that we need more research into and a better understanding of veterans' mental health. The action plan highlights many risk factors for veterans developing mental health problems, and it rightly notes that LGBTQ veterans may be at greater risk of poor mental health due to the discrimination they've historically faced in the armed forces. It also highlights older female veterans as being an at-risk group for suicide. It's vital that mental health services for veterans take the needs of at-risk groups into account and develop tailored support for people who may have experienced discrimination in the armed forces. It also notes that the intake of black and minority ethnic service personnel increased by 110% between March 2019 and March 2020 in the UK, and that mental health and wellbeing services should be cognisant of this growing cultural diversity in the future design and development of services. As I've said, we need person-centred services that seek to treat the individual and do not view veterans as a homogenous group with similar experiences. It's vital that this is supported by good data collection, not only on mental health outcomes for armed personnel and veterans, but on the demographics of the armed forces. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I welcome the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan, as well as the Government's commitment to supporting the mental health and wellbeing of veterans. Veterans have specific needs, which is why they need dedicated support which takes account of the unique stressors they've faced. The action plan represents an important step towards delivering truly person-centred care for Scotland's veterans.
Thank you. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Veterans, service personnel and their families contribute a huge amount to our society, and I welcome that the Scottish Government has made great strides in ensuring that our veterans and armed forces community in Scotland receive the best possible support and care, including as we emerge from the pandemic. And while they served, veterans may well have been involved in operations which are integral to our safety, our security and our wellbeing. The duty certainly places them in dangerous situations which can have a significant impact on both their physical and psychological health. The current Ukraine situation demonstrates this. People fleeing, turmoil, families split up, civilians staying behind to put themselves in harm's way. All of this will have a well-being consequences. So from the outset, Presiding Officer, I want to note the role of the third sector in promoting the importance of the health and well-being of our veterans. I welcome the commitment from the Scottish Government to supporting the third sector as we move forward with Scotland's journey to a wellbeing economy. accepting the recommendations of the Scottish Veterans Commissioner, Veterans Health and Wellbeing paper, the Scottish Government commissioned the Scottish Veterans Care Network to create a Veterans Mental Health and Action Plan. The Action Plan's 38 recommendations are based on three key principles, and it's worth repeating. Principle 1, veterans will have equal access to mental health and wellbeing services regardless of where they live, including rurally, which is important in my South Scotland region. Principle 2, veterans should be able to access the right help at the right time. And Principle 3, NHS boards, health and social care partnerships, local authorities and the third sector should be appropriately supported. To meet these principles, the Scottish Government has made available £1 million to create a fund to provide direct financial relief to the third sector organisations, including the Veterans Garden at the Crichton campus in D&G, which I'll come on to a wee bit later. The Scottish Government has been able to continue to fund the Unforgotten Forces Consortium, a partnership of 16 civilian and ex-service charitable organisations, and has contributed £500,000 over the next 2 years to support their work in improving the health, wellbeing and the quality of life for older veterans in Scotland. I also welcome that the Scottish Government is working to ensure that all veterans and armed forces personnel have access to suitable and safe housing and do not end up homeless. Following consultations with the housing sector, including the Veterans Scotland Housing Group, the Scottish Government published the Housing to 2040, Scotland's first long-term housing strategy. In particular, it is welcome that since 2012, over £6 million has been made available to deliver over 100 homes for veterans here in Scotland. In taking this work forward, I want to pay particular tribute to Dumfries and Galloway Housing Partnership, who have undertaken veteran awareness training and who have been part of the Veteran Housing Allocation Scheme in Scotland. Presiding Officer, across my South Scotland region, we have fantastic individuals and organisations who are committed to support our veterans and former armed forces personnel. At the Crichton campus in Dumfries, Mark Harper and his dedicated group of volunteers and local veterans run and maintain the Dumfries Veterans Garden. The Veterans Garden has focused on being a way to support ex-service personnel to help them through giving them a space to socialise, to learn and, of course, to garden, but also access confidential advice and support services with a focus on PTSD. The Veterans Garden run a monthly breakfast club also and a drop-in centre to provide participants with access to relevant information and advice with support from NHS Dumfries and Galloway and the Crichton Trust. In 2021, I was able to support and work with the Veterans Garden in NHS Dumfries and Galloway and NHS Dumfries and Galloway to secure endowment funding for the garden so that a relationship could be solidified between the NHS Mental Health Services and the Veterans Garden, which has proven to be massively beneficial. This funding has also allowed Alcohol and Drugs South West Scotland to work with the Veterans Garden and to have a drop-in service for everyone as well. So I want to thank also NHS Dumfries and Galloway Chief Executive Jeff Ace and Mark Harper, the veteran who runs the garden. Mark won the Volunteer of the Year award at the Scottish Veterans Awards. I want to thank them both for their work on this. I ask the Cabinet Secretary to join me in marking the success of Dumfries Veterans Garden and would invite him to come and visit when his diary allows. One final point, Presiding Officer, I want to also pay tribute to Robin Hood, who is a former veteran in Dumfries, who has been instrumental in supporting South West R&R and NITH Cree HGV training. Graeme Day will know that what I'm talking about because he visited when he was Veterans Minister a couple of years ago, actually, now. NITH Cree training, with funding from the Scottish Government, supports veterans to train to obtain their HGV licence and also to obtain security licences. The charity has supported and funded over 187 veterans to achieve their HGV licence, but also to enter into further employment. It is a great example of how local initiatives can be hugely successful in supporting our local veterans. Presiding Officer, I am happy to support the Government's motion. I welcome the steps which the Scottish Government are taking to support our veterans, especially in addressing stigma. It seems that every mental health debate, we pursue this issue and need to tackle stigma, and I realise that is so important. I've raised it myself on a number of debates already. So once again, I encourage the Government to continue to support the third sector and support this Government's motion as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a great pleasure to speak in this debate. But I think it is right to echo the words about the situation in Ukraine, which brings so much of what we've talked about this afternoon very close to home. I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary, particularly for his comments about the widening aspects of this debate, which needs to include the family of our veterans. It is, as the Cabinet Secretary said, an almost tripod situation where if you can't get every part that surrounds one of our veterans right, you fail the veteran, but you also fail those around. Those that have served our veterans are part of our community. They are our brothers and sisters, our fathers and mothers, and too frequently our children. And they are a valuable asset in Scotland's workplace and in Scotland's future. Only at the weekend, I was speaking to a major employer who had but praise for veterans who came in to their business, saying they brought skills that they couldn't find elsewhere. They brought a can-do attitude that they couldn't find elsewhere. And they brought people who were prepared to share with younger members of a team a way of doing things that perhaps those that had not served were unable to see. And it is important that when those that have served come to the end of that career, be it through time, be it through injury, or be it through some other choice, that there is a smooth transition into their civilian life. And I would like to echo Graham Day's comments about a holistic approach being needed towards this group, and indeed to Finlay Carson's very powerful vocalisation of the fact that there needs to be a tailored transition into civilian life that actually reflects the individual service personnel's experiences within the armed forces, and that that should continue when they are in civilian life to a tailored need to what they as individuals require. And it is right to echo Christine Graham's comment about the Armed Forces Covenant and the importance of talking about families, because I would like to spend some time discussing that aspect of this, not to take away from the needs of our veterans as individuals, but to highlight a group that surround our veterans and indeed are often the first point that notices a difference in these individuals. And I would like to pay credit to those charities and groups that work around with the veterans' families, and in particular to Forces Children Scotland, which is the renamed Royal Caledonian Education Trust, who I had the great privilege to meet with, and their work with both serving family children, but also those of veterans. Because when we look at this group, it is a very hard group to identify. Even the Ministry of Defence don't appear to know how many children there are of serving personnel, let alone veterans. And it is a welcome to see a change in the census to start to identify. Because unless we can quantify this group, unless we can identify their location, we are not going to be able to offer the tailored help that they need. And indeed the tailored help that these young people are crying out for, both to share their experiences, but also to be part of the solutions that they need. I had the privilege to listen to some armed forces children talking about the difficulty they have in civilian life, dealing both with other children who happen to be more open-minded than some adults, but also the challenge that they find in education when they move schools, when they go to new areas, to have to yet again retell their story about why they need different, specialised and individual help. Indeed, the charity collected quotes from our young people, and one that I would just like to share is in relation to the mental health of a young person who said, "I couldn't attend all CAMS appointments because we couldn't provide travel to all of the appointments. CAMS then discharged because of the length of time between appointments." It is tragic that a young person who has got to the top of a CAMS waiting list should suddenly lose that place because they're unable to travel to the CAMS appointment. I find it unbelievable that an adult could treat a young person that way, and not perhaps, as we so hope so many in Scotland can do, is to go that extra step and find a way to helping that young person. So, my call to the government is partly answered by with regard to the reference to the data already being collected, But I am going to suggest another way, and that is through the CMIS computer systems that exist across our education service. And if that could be used to identify young people whose parents or carers are already serving in the armed forces, or indeed are in the reserves, or indeed are veterans, we would be able to collate a central database of young people so that they could be identified with their needs and an individualised, holistic approach to the support they needed. It would also empower adults that surround those young people to be able to point out their almost unique position as forming part of a group that do require very specific, individualised help, which the young people are often only too keen to share with those adults. So I would be grateful if the government could take the opportunity to look to this, because just as we have veterans champions that sit within our local authorities and indeed some employers, it might be very good to have a young person's voice for those who come from our veterans, our serving and our reserve forces. I'm grateful.
Thank you. And I now call Kenneth Gibson, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The shocking events taking place in Ukraine, where soldiers and ordinary Ukrainians find themselves in a situation where they have no choice but to take up arms to protect their homeland against unprovoked and unjustified invasion by a foreign army, must serve as a reminder of the debt of gratitude we all owe to those who, over the generations, put their lives on the line to protect this country. That gratitude extends to those who serve today, and I'm sure that all members will agree that veteran service personnel and their families contribute a huge amount to our country, often in difficult circumstances, and the least we can do to thank them is to provide adequate support and access to the diverse range of services they may require upon leaving the forces. This must include adequate provision for former personnel who suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder and other mental health issues. Despite many financial challenges, the Scottish Government has increased direct investment in mental health support to £290 million a year, while also taking action to support veteran charities and the important work they do day in and day out. Like colleagues from across the Chamber, I welcome the Scottish Government's acceptance of recommendations in the Scottish Veterans Commissioner's Veterans Health and Wellbeing paper, commissioning the Scottish Veterans Care Network to create a Veterans Mental Health and Action Plan. As a local MSP for Two Islands, I'm particularly keen on progress being made with regards to Principle 1, which underpins the Action Plan's recommendations, the need for veterans to have equal access to mental health and wellbeing services, regardless of where in Scotland they live. I would like to thank the staff at NHS Ayrshire and Arran, whose services have been identified as one of six health boards in Scotland where veterans are able to access NHS community-based veteran-specific mental health and wellbeing services through first point centres such as the one in Irvine. Organisations ranging from Combat Stress and SAFA to Forces Children Scotland and MedSheds all help veterans' mental health and wellbeing. While most Forces personnel do not have mental health issues during their service or indeed afterwards, we must be proactive in assisting those who do. The Armed Forces Covenant is important but does not appear to include one specific group. And I wish to raise the issues that British nuclear test veterans have faced, a matter I previously spoke about in years gone by in this chamber. This year marks the 70th anniversary of Operation Hurricane, Britain's first atomic test, which was carried out in the Montebello archipelago off Western Australia. From 1952 to as late as 1991, many thousands of men, often on national service, were ordered to take part in 45 nuclear weapons tests and 593 so-called radioactive trials in Australia, the United States and South Pacific. Many young men were ordered to sit on a beach with their backs turned to the blast of the first explosion and cover their eyes with their hands. In most cases, due to the heat of the tropical sun, they were only lightly dressed and not issued with any personal protective equipment. In fact, many nuclear test veterans report seeing the bones inside their hands like an X-ray negative before a flash of light and a giant mushroom cloud formed in the sky. Several weeks later, many servicemen started feeling unwell, suffering the after effects of radiation exposure and sickness. And for the 7 decades since Operation Hurricane, many reported developing cancer as a result, that their wives miscarried repeatedly and that their children were born with physical and learning abnormalities. The impact on the mental health and well-being of these families as a result of their experience is incalculable. One test veteran, Ken McGinley from Johnston, was sent to Christmas Island aged 19 and exposed to 5 nuclear tests there, including the UK's biggest ever bomb, codenamed Grapple Y, on April 28, 1958. Like many other nuclear test veterans, he later became sterile and developed a rare blood cancer and was recently diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. Shockingly, successive UK governments have time after time refused to pay compensation to the many like Mr McGinley who suffered ill health as a result and even resisted awarding these veterans a medal for their service, arguing that, and I quote, they were not exposed to the same imminent danger as those on active service. Ken McGinley did not give up. In 1983, he founded the British Nuclear Test Veterans Association to gain recognition and restitution for British personnel who participated in the British and American nuclear tests and cleanups, along with scientists from the Atomic Weapons Research Establishment and indeed civilians. Last Thursday, on the morning that Russia invaded Ukraine, the UK Health Security Agency finally published the result of a new study which examined the mortality and cancer incidence experienced among men who took part in the UK's nuclear weapons test between 1952 and 1967. This latest research studied a cohort of 21,357 servicemen and male civilians from the UK who participated in the tests, and they found that those test veterans were 3.77 times more likely than the control group to die from chronic myeloid leukaemia, a type of bone cancer the report said is radiation-inducible. For example, half the crew of the destroyer HMS Diana, which was ordered to twice sail through the fallout plume in Operation Mosaic in 1956, died from tumours. Sadly, this new research only confirmed what nuclear veterans had known for a long time, although most have unfortunately since passed away, without ever having been given the respect owed to them by UK governments which spent millions on trying to deny them compensation. Presiding Officer, we owe a great deal to all servicemen and women who risk life, limb and their mental health to keep us safe. The Scottish Government is on the right track, ensuring veterans and their families receive the best possible support and access to services across Scotland. I hope the latest research on the mortality and cancer incidence and nuclear test veterans will encourage Scottish ministers to renew their calls to the UK Government for immediate compensation and medallic recognition and join the cross-party exhortations for a public inquiry into the injustices that so many veterans of nuclear testing have faced.
Thank you. I now call on Carol Mochan to wind up for Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And in closing for Scottish Labour, can I thank everyone for the very informative debate and also for the often heartfelt stories about constituents across Scotland. I think it is important that we discuss these matters in this chamber and thank people for their contributions in looking after us all, as we know so much about at this time. Can I share the thoughts and wishes of members from across the chamber as we pay our respects to those who have fallen in war or have suffered injury, particularly in terms of that often hidden pain associated with mental health, which is quite rightly today and now receiving the attention it deserves. As we have stated, Scottish Labour support the action plan and feel it is important that the actions happen and happen as quickly as possible. And as my colleague Paul O'Kane mentioned, it is really important that we pin down that we do have ongoing financial support to make these actions happen for people. As we have all watched the terrible scenes from the Ukraine this week, with the increasing horror, it has been an apt reminder of the brutal and unforgiving nature of war, which many people in our communities remain victims of, and those who have served perhaps feel most acutely and will be doing so at the moment. The struggles that follow can continue for decades, as we've heard from many members. And we know that with a great deal of people who have left the military are heightened risk of suicide because of the experience they have had and perhaps a lack of the support that they have received in the past. That needs to be a thing of the past, and we can make steps forward today, as we have heard in the chamber. As an MSP for the south of Scotland, I know Archie, a serving councillor as well, and I thank Finlay Carson for mentioning all the work that he has done, and I certainly will take that back to him to let him know that we do appreciate all of the work that he does for veterans in the area. Like many others today, I have met and worked alongside members of our armed forces community during campaigns and outreaches down the years. And in that time, I have been struck by the deep sense of commitment and dedication they have not only to their country, but to those who have went before them. And they have a great commitment to the places that they live, and I think Audrey Nicol expressed that very, very well. Many of the charities and community groups we all work with on a daily basis have people from the forces background at their heart, using the skills that they have learned to better improve the places that they come from. If we can reflect a sense of that commitment today and help them to get the fair treatment that they deserve, then we will be giving something worthwhile back to those people who have done so much for our country. It is with that in mind that my party believes it is so important that the Scottish Government include the considerations of veterans more prominently in the new suicide prevention strategy, and I was glad to hear the Minister make that commitment. Specifically seeking to deliver veterans-specific suicide prevention training and improve access to mental health support for veterans. Currently, what we offer is far from adequate in many places, and we have heard it can be different around the country, but it is only fair that people receive the same parity of service. This could save lives both in the short term and as we go through the years, so in the years to come. As such, I do reiterate the importance of supporting Scottish Labour's amendment, and I join my colleagues in asking the Government to update the Parliament to that effect as soon as is practically possible. Achieving these reforms will help us to appreciate the significance of war on those who fought and their families, both physically and mentally. It is with this in mind that I especially believe and support the action plan that we should look at the more holistic situation around veterans and do more to ensure our veterans have better access to employment and health services. And I did hear many members in the Chamber and the Minister refer to this. We all know that this has to happen to make things better for people. Crucially, an understanding that many people leave their time with the forces facing a very uncertain housing future. I think this is a very important point, which has been raised many times in the Chamber before and, of course, today by other members. Housing future has a direct and lasting impact on anyone's mental health. But of course, perhaps from our veterans who have moved about so much, it is important that they have a sense of where their home is. I recognise and welcome the debate across the chamber about the housing issue, but I hope that we can have some further clarity on how we support people with this issue. It is not acceptable, and across the UK we should reflect that. So reaching out also involves giving veterans and their families a place to talk. As such, I welcome the work of groups such as First Point Ayrshire Arran in my own community, who also help people with a forces background to find jobs, housing, supportive sort of outlets to share their experiences. Equally in my area, there are many active chapters of the SSAFA, the Armed Forces Charity, the British Royal Legion, and we have heard of other work ongoing in other constituencies. This work is exceptional, and the exceptional charity work in the community for their own members and those in need across the region. All of these groups play a massive part in helping to solve the issues we have been speaking about today, and many members have congratulated them and mentioned them. But, as with all things, it requires decisive funding from central government as well, and I hope that we can ensure that funding continues for these important charitable organisations. Can I close by drawing attention to a more recent struggle that the Armed Forces have helped with? Of course, their vital role in the pandemic, and I'm aware I'm out of time, but I thought it was important just to share that modern aspect.
I think you've got that on the record, I'm responsible, and indeed you are out of time. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I now call on Russell Finlay to wind up for the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Finlay.
Thank you. I would like to begin by thanking Keith Brown for bringing today's debate. As an opposition MSP and with my party's responsibility for the community safety brief, it's my job to challenge and ask questions of the Cabinet Secretary. Fair to say it's not always harmonious, but in this debate today I think it's important to acknowledge loudly and clearly Mr Brown's past military service for our country as a Royal Marine, and I do so with absolute respect. I will come back later to the points he made about my party's amendment to his motion. Deputy Presiding Officer, as a new MSP, I had the privilege of laying a wreath in the cenotaph in Paisley on Remembrance Sunday. When silence fell, I was overwhelmed by profound feelings of admiration and appreciation for all those who made the ultimate sacrifice for the freedoms we often take for granted. I did so as a civilian, surrounded by men and women who have served or are still in service. I think it's a reasonable assumption that civilians like myself, and indeed most of us, can never really truly appreciate what it is like to fill the boots and shoes of our Army, Navy and Air Force personnel. That realisation is even more pronounced today as we watch with growing shock, sadness and disgust what is happening in Ukraine. The horrors of war have never been more visceral or more vivid, captured in high-definition smartphones and beamed around the world in an instant. The stories of heroism and tragedy can overwhelm. One that hit me especially hard was that murder of a 10-year-old girl called Polina and her parents, gunned down in the street by Putin's death squads. While we pray for peace and for Putin to be brought to justice, it is humbling and emotional to witness ordinary Ukrainians taking up arms to defend their territory, their democracy and their freedom. This includes people from all walks of life, including parliamentarians like ourselves. Few among us can imagine what that would feel like, but there are some. Deputy Presiding Officer, I've already mentioned the Cabinet Secretary, but we are fortunate that many other members, past and present, have also served. These include Paul Sweeney on the benches opposite, and my Scottish Conservative colleague Edward Mountain, who spent 12 proud years in the Blues and Royals and who would very much like to be here today. Then there is a former Scottish Conservative member, Maurice Corrie, who devoted decades to the British Army and who still chairs the Parliament's cross-party group on Armed Forces and Veterans Community. I know that Mr Corrie and the CPG have long championed the rights of veterans living in Scotland. In his 2015 report, Transition in Scotland, the first Scottish Veterans Commissioner, Eric Fraser, talked about his difficulty in transitioning from a life in naval uniform to becoming a civvy. We are familiar with stories of service personnel struggling to cope as they leave behind a military life of discipline and structure. Many years ago, I spoke with a man called Tom Howard, a former parachute regiment medic, who suffered post-traumatic stress disorder after serving in the Falkland Islands. I was delighted to discover that Mr. Howard's personal testimony has now been recorded and posted on a Veterans Video Archive website. While he was fortunate to overcome his demons, others are not so lucky, as has already been touched upon by Mr. Sweeney in his very moving contribution. And while the narrative of the broken soldier has taken root, I would like to echo a very important point made earlier by Mr. Hoy. By virtue of the media giving voice to veterans in need of help, it can lead to a public perception that, as Mr. Hoy put it, all veterans are broken, when in fact the vast majority make the transition to civilian life greatly enhanced by their time in the military. However, as Mr. Hoy also said, it's a matter of collective shame whenever a veteran who has put their life on the line for us does not get the support they need if they fall victim to homelessness, addiction problems, mental health challenges and suicide. The main substance of today's debate relates to the Veterans Mental Health and Wellbeing Action Plan, which has been jointly published by NHS Scotland and the Scottish Veterans Care Network. Scottish Veterans Commissioner Charlie Wallace provides the foreword for this substantial and detailed report, which contains 38 recommendations based on three key principles. To summarise, the first of these is to ensure that veterans will have equal access to mental health and wellbeing services, regardless of where they live. The second is a guarantee that veterans should be able to access the right help at the right time, while the third is that they are supported by the NHS and a wide range of other organisations. All of us here today are in agreement with each other about the contents of this document. However, my party has put forward a very sensible amendment that seeks to ensure these shared sentiments are assessed and implemented within a defined timescale of 2 years. I'm disappointed at the Cabinet Secretary's accusation that this is an attempt to undermine the government motion. That is absolutely not the case. I am advised that parliamentary rules do not allow for multiple amendments in different places. So without the explicitly stated commitment on delivery, we all know how even simple and effective reform, for which there is consensus, can sometimes become tangled in red tape and withered by inertia. While I commend the motion in Mr Hoy's name, my party also agrees with the substance of both the Scottish Government motion and the Labour Party's amendment. Presiding Officer, to conclude, I hope that in the cause of mutual agreement in this important debate, they too can support our amendment in the spirit in which it is intended. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Kevin Stewart, Minister, to wind up the debate on behalf of the Scottish Government. Please take us to decision time at 5 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'm going to begin, as many members have today, and talk about the horrific Russian invasion of Ukraine and the impact that that is having on the Ukrainian people, but also the impact that it is having on people here. And Julian McCrae was right to point out that the situation in Ukraine may well be re-traumatising people here and now. People can get help. They can contact Breathing Space on 0800 83 85 87 if that is the case, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank members for their valuable contributions today. And there has been a lot of consensus across the Chamber. And as the Cabinet Secretary has already pointed out, we'll support the Labour amendment today, and I'll talk more about that later. Veterans continue their service in Scotland once they've left the forces. Veterans I know personally work as electricians, have been police officers, and the veteran to my left, Mr Brown, now serves as a Cabinet Secretary in this place. And last year, one of my officials had her car rescued by a veteran who was an AA support worker. When he heard that she worked in mental health policy, he recited this poem to her, explaining the sometimes devastating impact of mental ill health. It's called The Enemy from Within. This is a warning to all former brothers at arms, so they know that they may still be at harm. At harm from who, I hear you say, we left all our enemies in lands far away. This enemy has many faces, but none you will see. He will whisper and taunt without reprise, filling every thought, even in your sleep. He tells you and shows things you never want to see again, making him stronger and bringing you pain. If not talked about and left in your head, he will take until you have nothing left. Before it's too late, go look in the mirror. Repeat in the mirror. I'm not the enemy. He's called PTSD. I'd like to thank Brian Jackson, the poet, for that moving reflection on post-traumatic stress disorder. The Cabinet Secretary made an important point in his opening remarks that I want to reiterate again now. Veterans and their families often face unique challenges in terms of their mental health. But that does not mean we should not think in terms of prevention and early intervention. Recovery is possible. But achieving our aspirations will need a cross-policy approach with a real and sustained focus on the stigma that veterans often experience. In Scotland, we have done a great deal in tackling stigma through the Scottish Government-backed See Me campaign. And we know that veterans face particular stigma. And I want to make sure that we understand the impact this has on veterans and work to change the attitudes and behaviours that perpetuate this. Stigma has been mentioned by many of the contributors today, including Mr Sweeney. So I'm pleased to announce today that we will resource and work with CME on a veteran campaign to better understand these issues. We will listen to veterans and we will address stigma together. Mr. Brown mentioned that housing and homelessness is an issue close to my heart, and that is the case. Sometimes I could have been doing without the previous Veterans Minister, Mr. Day, who was very vociferous on veterans' housing, and rightly so. And the work that we are taking forward in that area is crucial. Together with work and employability, better data, which again has been mentioned by many today, and the right pathways to help and support, and of course there are many more. And one of those areas is meeting the needs of veterans in community-based approaches. I'll give way to Mr. Hoy.
Craig Hoy.
I thank the Minister for giving way. Just further to the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks, obviously Mr. Finlay has confirmed that we couldn't amend his motion in, or the Government's motion in more than one place. And given that the motion, the amendment that we've tabled to the motion is largely the Government's motion, but with the requirement for an assessment and some action within 2 years, would the Minister agree to that, and would he therefore support our amendment this evening?
We will not support the amendment this evening. And you know, there is always a difficulty in writing amendments. I get that, but we can all do it. And we can cooperate and we can talk to one another around about how we can amend things to get what we want. That did not happen, and I'm afraid that we cannot accept the amendment. And that's a great pity, because as Mr. Brown rightly pointed out, we've had consensus across this Parliament previously, particularly with Mr. Corey in the lead previously, to ensure that we got things right for our veterans. I'm sorry, we can't accept it, but in future, come and talk to us and we can see what we can do. I was talking about the needs of veterans and community-based approaches, Presiding Officer, and that includes in suicide prevention. And I want to add to the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks by touching on this now, but also to touch upon the Labour amendment. Because as we develop our new suicide prevention strategy, we will engage with organisations representing veterans' interests. And through our work to deliver on our Suicide Prevention Action Plan, NHS Education for Scotland and Public Health Scotland have produced a range of learning resources on suicide prevention, and we will work with veterans' organisations to tailor these learning resources to meet the specific needs of veterans and to raise awareness of these resources and encourage their uptake. We need to do better to understand and address issues faced by groups at heightened risk of suicide, including veterans. We must listen more to the voices of lived experience. And together with COSLA, we are developing that new long-term suicide prevention strategy for Scotland, which will now be published in September this year. And in the development of our new strategy, we will ensure that veterans are at its very heart. And I have to say that we also need to work with veterans organisations in developing our new self-harm strategy, which Mr. Hoy, Ms. Mackay, Ms. Bailey and Mr. Cole Hamilton have engaged with us on. Presiding Officer, the range of work that has been mentioned today illustrates how important it is for us to continue to work collaboratively on these issues. There have been some outstanding examples of this, even during the challenges of the pandemic. And many members have mentioned some of the things that have gone on in their own constituencies and regions, which are absolutely immense. Mr. Carson mentioned Archie Drybra, as did Carol Morgan. I've met Archie on a number of occasions, and he's a powerful force, it has to be said, and that's a good thing. Audrey Nicholl mentioned the Gordon Highlanders Museum and the veteran volunteers that carry out work there. They are indeed immense, and Jackie Dunbar is, I believe, still a member of the board of that museum, and at this point she would probably want me to say bye, Dan, so I will, just to keep her sweet as we move forward. Presiding Officer, there have also been issues that, sadly, we have not really talked about in the depth that we should have before. Those veterans, LGBTQ plus veterans, who have faced some real trauma, not only in terms of their service in the front line, but also those that were thrown out of the armed forces. Mr. O'Kane, in his speech, talked about the misunderstanding of their challenges. I think Mr. O'Kane was being very diplomatic in terms of all of that. Let me turn to some of the other points that were made during the course of the speech. Christine Graham, as per usual, never minces her words and asked how we are going to do all of this and make sure that it reaches everybody nationwide. And Graham Day also mentioned no postcode lotteries.
Minister, Scottish, could I ask you to wind up?
I will indeed, Presiding Officer. The Scottish structure will emerge from the action plan, will create a Scottish-wide, one-door approach to all of this to ensure that we get it right for everyone. Finally, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government values and appreciates those who have served their country and recognises the myriad of sacrifices made by so many to protect the freedoms we enjoy today. Some of the work I have outlined today will play a key role in ensuring that the right mental health support is available across multiple levels of need and recognising the unique circumstances faced by veterans and their families. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on a Scottish approach. Point of order, Daniel Johnston.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Today, the Scottish Government held an event in Dundee to launch a document which sets out a 10-year economic plan. Clearly, this is intended to be a document of significance that will shape both decision-making and indeed spending for this Parliament and next for the Scottish Government in this area. It is, of course, convention that the Government makes statements to Parliament if they're of a significant nature. And I just wondered if you share my disappointment that it chose to hold an event with private invitees rather than placing this document in Parliament and announcing it by a ministerial statement, which I believe previous strategies have done so. Indeed, can I ask whether or not yourself or indeed the Parliamentary Bureau received a request prior to this launch to hold such a statement prior to being published and shared with the public?
I thank Mr. Johnston for his point of order. While government-initiated questions are one of the mechanisms by which the government can make information available to the Parliament, as I said, this issue was discussed at Bureau earlier, and as I said at Bureau earlier, I do expect the government to consider what the best mechanism is for each significant announcement, particularly on a day when the Parliament is sitting. And while the response to the GIQ does state that there will be a debate on the strategy held at a later date, I am sympathetic to the member's query about whether this was the most appropriate mechanism to use for announcing this strategy for the reasons I've outlined. At Bureau today, I asked the Minister to reflect on the choice of this mechanism, and the Minister committed to look at this, and I expect the Minister to update Bureau members at the earliest opportunity. Thank you. Point of order, Stephen Kerr.
In relation to your ruling on Daniel Johnston's point of order, can I ask you, Presiding Officer, perhaps to be more specific about when you expect the Minister to come back? This is a vitally important policy announcement. It's been made to a closed meeting in Dundee, and it is vitally important that these matters are brought to this chamber and are discussed and scrutinised by the members of this Parliament. So could I ask for your guidance? Could I ask for you to intercede with the government and to insist that such a statement is brought to this Parliament, hopefully even tomorrow?
I thank Mr. Kerr for his point of order. I am sure that Mr. Kerr shares my view that the Minister was in no doubt as to the strength of feeling expressed by the Bureau this morning, and that the Minister will take that seriously and will indeed report to the Bureau and myself at the first opportunity. Now, We were concluding the debate, so the debate on a Scottish approach to the mental health and wellbeing of our veterans in each community is now concluded, and we'll move on to the next item of business, which is an announcement by the Finance and Public Administration Committee on an inquiry into the National Performance Framework Ambitions into Action. And I call on Kenneth Gibson, convener of the committee, to make the announcement.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Members will be aware that the National Performance Framework, introduced in 2007, sets out the strategic outcomes which collectively describe the kind of Scotland it aims to create. The NPF also aims to guide the decisions and actions of national and local government. But how well does it do this? That is the subject of a Finance and Public Administration Committee inquiry launched today. Separately, a statutory review of the national outcomes in the NPF is planned for 2023. The Deputy First Minister has confirmed that engagement on this review will begin later this year. The NPF is, of course, a cross-cutting initiative of interest to the wider Parliament. And so, while the committee expects to lead on parliamentary scrutiny of the review, other committees will, of course, wish to examine the draft outcomes and proposals that impact their own portfolio areas. In our pre-budget report, we pointed to this upcoming review as an opportunity to, and I quote, reposition the NPF at the heart of government planning from which all priorities and plans should flow, close quote, and asked the government to consider how the NPF could be more closely linked to budget planning. In his blog on the Christie, 10 years on of 7 September 2021, the Auditor-General for Scotland noted that Scotland is suffering from, and I quote, a major implementation gap between policy ambitions and delivery on the ground, close quotes. Our inquiry builds on this evidence rather than duplicating the work of the upcoming review. We want to look in more detail at how the outcomes shape Scottish Government policy aims and spending decisions, and in turn, how this drives delivery at national and local level. The remit of the inquiry is therefore to look at the current structures, processes, cultures and behaviours that are in place to help deliver national outcomes. The call for views on our inquiry, the National Performance Framework, Ambitions into Action, is now live on our committee web pages. We would encourage submissions from all those listed in the NPF as having a role in delivery of the outcomes. That is national and local government, businesses, voluntary organisations and anyone living in Scotland. We'll then be holding informal sessions with organisations and groups at the heart of delivering the national outcomes to establish the picture on the ground. We'll explore these issues more in all evidence and we'll then plan to report our findings in September. Finally, the NPF aims to get everyone in Scotland to work together to achieve the national outcomes. And so we'd also welcome views from members and committees. Members might have heard of good practice in their areas or views on how delivery can be improved, while committees may have received evidence during the course of their work about delivery in their portfolio areas. Either way, we look forward to receiving your responses.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions 3409 on referral of an SSI and 3410 on suspension of standing orders.
And move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time, and there are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 3381.1 in the name of Craig Hoy, which seeks to amend Motion 3381 in the name of Keith Brown on a Scottish approach to the mental health and wellbeing of our veterans in each community, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.